There was never any question about the beginning of World War II for the United States. Pearl Harbor began it crisply and decisively and without discussion. Absolutely nobody was prepared for it. I remember thinking with a sense of the profoundest awe that none of our lives would ever be the same, that a social, even a cultural watershed had been crossed, which we could never go back over. And I wondered how many of us would survive to see the end results. I wondered if I would. I had just turned 20 the month before. It was one of the first, tiniest steps in what I've labeled the evolution of a soldier. So wrote James Jones in his 1975 documentary narrative entitled WW2. Jones was in a unique position to trace in a trilogy of war novels the evolution of a soldier. He was serving in the U.S. Army in the territory of Hawaii when the Japanese attack came and was later wounded at Guadalcanal. This documentary traces Jones' own journey, the evolution of a writer from Reveille to Taps.
Did he always, in conversation with him or what you know about him, did he always see himself as a Midwesterner? Did he always hang on to those roots as a small-town Illinois writer, or did he try to distance himself?
I think, if anything, he tried to distance himself. He wasn't self-conscious about it. It just came out of him. If you meet someone who's got a strong Southern accent, doesn't matter what they're doing, you know they're a Southerner, and Jim had, however you'd characterize, I guess, a Southern Illinois accent, but it was there. And it was part of his charm. I mean, here was this man who was so smart and so funny and could say such unexpected things and sounded like a hick. That was terrific. He didn't know it was terrific, though.
Robinson, an archetypal American town near the Wabash River in southeastern Illinois. James Jones was born here on November 6, 1921. Like Mark Twain's Hannibal, Jones's hometown is the commercial hub of a rural area on the northern rim of the South. Robinson is a tightly knit community where everyone knows everyone else's family ties, family skeletons, and net worth. Jones was deeply affected by the town, and despite his uneasy relations with its solid citizens, continued to call Robinson and nearby Marshall his home until his mid-30s. Writing in 1951, after the tremendous success of From Here to Eternity, he said, "I would not live permanently anywhere else." James Ramon Jones was the second of three children of Ramon and Ada Jones. He is pictured here with his father, Dr. Ray, the town dentist, his older brother, Jeff, and his mother. His sister, Mary Ann, was 2 years younger than Jim and closer to him than any member of his family. His grandfather, George W. Jones, was a judge and a lawyer and one of the most prominent members of the community. The Jones family became wealthy on oil income, and Grandfather Jones built this mansion around the turn of the century. The bulk of his wealth was lost in the Depression.
Victor, can you tell me what kind of town Robinson is?
Well, in my opinion, it's a splendid little town to live in and to work in. It's small, comparatively, with something like, I suppose, 6,000-7,000 population, mostly Anglo-Saxon, and that doesn't mean anything except that we've had no problems of any kind, and it could be just the same if we had any other nationality other than Anglo-Saxon.
You visited Marshall in Robinson, Illinois, where your father grew up. What kind of places are they?
They're very small. It seemed very small to me, small town, you know. It's exactly the way, it was so strange. It felt like a deja vu to drive in to Robinson, Illinois, and see that square with the courthouse right in the middle. And
did he talk to you much about his father?
I remember when he told me that his father had shot himself in the mouth, that he'd killed himself, and he was very very hurt by it. You know, it scarred him terribly, I think. And I said, why? And he said, because he was unhappy. And that, he didn't talk much about his childhood at all. And it's like I have just small pieces of a big puzzle that when I went down to Robinson, I slowly put back together.
So you were essentially in the same school system with him all the way through high school?
All the way through, yes. Right.
What kind of a boy was he?
Well, he was a little strange, but the fact that he wanted to mix with children, with the other kids, but he didn't know how to do it. His mother was a very domineering person. And I don't really, frankly, think, and so I found out later, that his home life was very bad.
He was a shy boy. He followed me around for all during the seventh grade and probably spoke 10 words to me in all that time.
What were his parents like?
Well, his father drank a great deal. Many people were afraid to go to him for professional services. But he did pull a tooth for me. And he was a quiet man. His mother was just the opposite. She wanted to be in everything. She was a joiner.
Farrell, what's your first memory of Jim Jones?
As a little boy coming over to the library. He was always very eager to get there, and he was pretty good when he was in that, considering the trouble he made otherwise. He was pretty good in the library.
Was he, what, how old was he?
Oh, riding a tricycle.
There was a Carnegie Library in my hometown in Illinois, and looking back on it now, I'm sure that building and its contents and the people who ran it had a great deal more to do with my becoming a writer than I had any concept of at the time. It was less than half a block from my house, that library. Out the back door, through my backyard, then across a vacant lot. It was run by two ladies who were willing to direct my reading, without my knowledge, into ever more and more subtle lines.
But my first memory of Jim is on a tricycle riding back and forth in the neighborhood. And he always had his jaw stuck out, like he would just expect somebody to hit us.
What kind of books did he read?
Before I was out of grade school, I was moving from the Kipling, Stevenson, and Scott of the basement up into the Shakespeare, Hardy, and Conrad of the upstairs.
He read a lot. That's about all I can say.
Well, I heard
down there it was picture books, and at that age, and then as he grew older, he was one of those that had read every book in the library, and he wanted to come upstairs because he was going to read adult books. He'd read all of the others downstairs, and he really, they can't read all of them like that, but he felt he did.
Well, did you let him read the adult books?
Oh, sure. We did some of them. We didn't, that wasn't the card for the children's library. It did not pass upstairs, but there were a lot of books up there, but a lot of duplicates both places, the same book.
You made an exception for him.
Well, yes, he had a number of exceptions made for him. You couldn't help but like him. You could get aggravated at him, but you liked him.
As a boy, when you knew him in junior high and high school, was he interested in books and literature then?
Yes. I think he read everything there was to read in the library. And classes in high school became quite boring to him because he had already advanced beyond the basic stage. And he'd either sleep or get sent to the hall or the study, I mean to the hallway or the study hall. So as far as classroom is concerned, he really didn't spend too much time in class, but he passed. And I was asked the other day whether or not he graduated from school. He most certainly did. I remember him on the football field in his marching uniform, strutting along just as well as any of the rest, but his hat was always on one side. So he was an individual. That's how I remember Jim, an individual who was apart from the rest.
That was 1939.
In the late 1930s, an itinerant filmmaker shot some footage of Robinson. In this scene, the students of Robinson High School, including a teenager named Jim Jones, passed before his camera. After graduation, Jones was at loose ends. The family's fortunes had further declined, and college seemed remote. The Depression was still on, and jobs were scarce. So at the urging of his father, Jones enlisted in the U.S. Army Air Corps in November of 1939 at Chanute Field, Illinois. He wrote later that he immediately regretted his decision, but as it turned out, the Army was one of the luckiest things that ever happened to him.
In those days, when a young man joined the Army, it was because he was at the end of his tether as far as the rest of the American civilization was concerned. So therefore, it would seem to me that he had a very unhappy time in his hometown.
So he was escaping into the Army?
I would think so. Mm-hmm. It happened, in this his case, to be a very lucky escape. As he found himself in the Army, he found the structures that he could admire and in which he could live. He found a sense of authority that he admired, sense of power, the sense of comradeship with men that always meant a great deal to him. The idea of violence close to the surface, which plays such a big part in all his books. That's where the Army, I think, helped him find.
Shortly after he enlisted, Jones was assigned to Hickam Field in the territory of Hawaii. He didn't like the Army Air Corps and soon transferred to the infantry. By the beginning of 1941, he was stationed at nearby Schofield Barracks, exactly like his fictional character, Robert E. Lee Pruitt, played here by Montgomery Clift in the movie version of From Here to Eternity. Writing of Jones in Hawaii, Joan Didion said, "Certain places seem to exist mainly because someone has written about them. Kilimanjaro belongs to Ernest Hemingway. Oxford, Mississippi belongs to William Faulkner. A place belongs forever to whoever claims it hardest, remembers it most obsessively, wrenches it from itself, shapes it, renders it, loves it so radically that he remakes it in his image. And not only Schofield Barracks, but a great deal of Honolulu has always belonged for me to James Jones." Jones served for a time as assistant clerk of F Company. This gave him access to a typewriter on which he posted a sign which read, "Genius at Work." His closest friend, and undoubtedly the model for Pruitt, was one of the company's two buglers, a Kentuckian named Robert Lee Stewart. Like Pruitt, Stewart refused to box for the company team and was said to have endured a living hell as a result. According to Stewart and other members of the company, Jones had few friends and spent much of his time reading and writing. Then came Pearl Harbor. Jones's unit, the 27th Infantry Regiment, spent the year after the Japanese attack building defensive positions on the island of Oahu and training for jungle combat. In a May 1942 letter to his sister Marianne, nicknamed Tinkus, Jones said he thought he would be killed in the war and complained bitterly of the Army's indignities, favoritism, graft, and red tape. He said, quote, "The sooner the Jap comes, the better it will suit me. I think I will enjoy jabbing my bayonet into a man's belly and watching the agony on his face." He added a P.S. "I wish I was a dog. Dogs just eat and sleep and bark." Jones Jones may have had good reason to complain about favoritism. In the summer of 1942, his application for officer candidate school was turned down by his company commander, Captain William M. Blatt, who wrote, "The applicant is a more or less studious type, but is erratic. He is usually either elated or despondent and seems to run no middle course." In the leadership section of the application, Blatt concluded by saying, "No outstanding qualities of leadership were evident," and noted that he would be, quote, "reluctant to have Jones serve under him as a combat officer." Guadalcanal was the first American offensive anywhere, and as such, got perhaps more than its fair share of notoriety. There was an air of adventure and sense of individual exploit about it, and small units of platoon and company strength still maintained importance. My outfit landed in November 1942. No living soul that saw us come hustling ashore could have believed that 3 months later, we would be known as the famed 25th Tropic Lightning Division. I came out of it with a Purple Heart and a Bronze Star, the latter given to me by a process as random as the mortar shell that hit me. I think I screamed when I was hit. Then I blacked out and came to several yards down the slope with the blood running all down my face. It wasn't really so bad. It hadn't hurt at all. The thing I was most proud of was that I remembered to toss my full canteen of water to one of the men from the company.
His experiences in the war, did they have something to do with this quality of gentleness that he had, or was it always there? Or?
I think he was born gentle, and I think he had the most terrible war. I think for a young man to have gone off and... Did Kaylie tell you about... He had to kill a young man his own age. He wrote about it anyway in the Thin Red Line. I think that did him in. I mean, he couldn't stand that, and he became such a pacifist after that.
He did.
Yeah.
I know he wrote somewhere that bravery was the most pernicious of virtues because it forced men to do things that they might not do under other circumstances.
Yeah. He used to get so frustrated when young people felt they lost something by not going to the war. He felt so sad for them, because that isn't the way to find your manhood.
Was the gusto that he had for life, how was that connected with the sadness he'd seen at life? Was it sort of a response to the sadness that he'd known?
I thought about that a lot. Maybe. Mm-hmm. But I also think that after he met that poor Japanese soldier, he said, "I'm going to live a good life."
You knew Jim as a boy, a kindergarten, and then you saw him when he came back after the war. How much did the war change him?
Well, I would say a great deal. You couldn't spend 5 or 6 years during World War II and the way he spent it, a lot of it in combat, without having a great deal of change. But he did have this urge to write. And I think that the fact that he did it was... promoted and encouraged by Lonnie Handy. If it hadn't been for Lonnie Handy, there would have been no Jim Jones.
Lonnie Turner Handy's first service to James Jones was to obtain his discharge from the Army. She was a friend of Jones's Uncle Charlie and Aunt Sadie, and saw tremendous promise in his artistic abilities. Married to Harry Handy, the superintendent of the Ohio oil refinery in Robinson, Lonnie was unable to bear children, and had made a virtual career of guiding, coaxing, and cajoling young writers, high school and college students, and returning GIs. Jones was AWOL in November 1943 and again in May 1944. His commanding officer at Camp Campbell wrote to Lonnie to seek her help in convincing Jones to return, and noted that under the Articles of War, he could be considered a deserter. Lonnie wrote back to say that Jones was a writer of rare promise, brilliant, undoubtedly a genius, and compared him with Hemingway, Wolfe, and Dos Passos. Jones returned to Camp Campbell and was arrested and spent time in the prison ward of the station hospital. The exchange of letters continued, and largely through her efforts, charges against Jones were dropped, and he was discharged on July 6, 1944. For the next 13 years, Lonnie and Jim lived and worked together.
You heard the story of how he got interested in Lonnie. Well, they went to a big, Charlie had a big party, and no, I wasn't there. And they got to talking poetry and quotations and things like that. And they were so absorbed in what each one was showing of what they'd read and what they remembered and that sort of thing, that they just forgot everybody around them.
Did people in Robinson think that she was sort of ahead of her time?
They thought she was a kook.
Her interest in young people and helping them, was that mainly during the period, during the war and after the war?
It was before the war, in the early 30s. Mid-30s, I will say. And many of our classmates of 39 were frequent visitors there.
I remember that the young people that I knew who had been my students were attracted to it.
Why were they attracted to Loney?
I think it was because Loney had provided a place for them to come. That was to her home before they ever went to the colony, where they could express themselves. The mothers resented her very, very much, so the pitched battles was between the parents and Loney, and the kids were caught in the middle.
What was these mothers that were friends of yours, these parents and Tanya, what was their opinion of Loney?
I think they thought Loney had a devil's cult down at her home and was dragging these youngsters down there in the evenings, having them participate.
How much sympathy was there for anything artistic in Robinson in those years?
How much sympathy is for anything artistic in Robinson today?
She would give you anything. You just ask. It was yours. And my mother and I, and I don't remember who else was along, but we took her to the airport in Indy. She was going to fly to New York. And my mother admired her dress. I'll never forget, it was a black linen dress. And the next thing I knew, she was in the restroom, came back out. She didn't have anything on, a slip and a coat. She got on the plane, went to New York with nothing on.
She took all barriers away and wanted that person to go and find his true voice and give whatever he had. She felt that gifts are returned, as in Christianity. And her most favorite parable was the one of the phoenix bird. She would say it over and over. You only live through redemption. You only live through rising from your dead ashes. You have to die, and then you're reborn. Actually, so much of American literature is concerned with that, rebirth.
Jones was restless and rebellious at this stage of his life and certainly needed the sort of help that Loney wanted so much to give. After a brief stay with Uncle Charlie and Aunt Sadie at the old Jones mansion, Jim moved in with the Handys on Mulberry Street. A short time later, in a remarkable act of generosity, the Handys added a room to their house for Jim. It was here that the bulk of From Here to Eternity and an earlier unpublished novel, They Shall Inherit the Laughter, were written, from 1944 to 1950. In January 1945, Jones submitted the Laughter manuscript to Maxwell Perkins, the legendary Scribner's editor of Hemingway, Wolfe, and Fitzgerald. Perkins found merit in the novel, but ultimately rejected it. What did interest Perkins was Jones' casual suggestion that he write a novel about the pre-war army in Hawaii. With a $500 advance from Scribner's in hand, Jones began work on the new novel in early 1946. Based loosely on the experiences of his friend Robert Lee Stewart, the novel ends with Pearl Harbor and the death of Pruitt, who was killed at YLA Golf Course while trying to rejoin his unit after the Japanese attack, as shown here in the movie version of From Here to Eternity. Perkins' death in June 1947 left Jones distraught, but he continued work on the novel under the direction of Perkins' associate, Burroughs Mitchell. Over the next 2.5 years, Jones worked on the novel in a number of locations: South Carolina, Florida, Arizona, California, and at the Handy House in Robinson. Loney often accompanied Jones on these trips, while Harry, who underwrote their cost, usually remained at home. By February 1950, the novel was finished. Although under pressure from Scribner's, he was required to reduce the number of obscenities in the manuscript. Helen Howe, the wife of Jones' friend Tinks Howe, describes this process.
He had to remove a certain number of four-letter words from the galleys, and it was in the galleys that he had to do it. And so we're sitting at the table at Loney's. There are four or five of us sitting around the table proofing galleys, and every time we'd come to one of Jim's fantastic four-letter words, we'd say, the sentence says so-and-so, can we take that one out? Hell no. And as it turned out, Max Perkins had told him he had to delete, I think it was 63, but he only found 51 he'd take out. And so, but that evening was fun. We had a lot of fun with Jim's inability to express himself in accepted English.
After an extensive publicity campaign, From Here to Eternity appeared in February 1951. Scribner's expected the book to do well, but did not anticipate its tremendous appeal to both reviewers and the book-buying public. It was a blockbuster, and soon shot to the top of the bestseller list. Comparisons with Norman Mailer's 1948 bestseller, The Naked and the Dead, were inevitable, since both were long, realistic Army novels written by veterans of Pacific combat. Mailer describes his reaction to Eternity.
You know, it knocked me down, half knocked me out. I thought it was an extraordinary book, and all the while I was reading it, I kept feeling, having a sinking feeling, well, you're no longer the most talented writer to come out of World War II. You've been replaced. And extraordinary sensation. I've always felt I understood kings losing their crown ever since. And then I remember, so I gave it a blurb. It was a half-grudge, half-generous blurb on the order of, you know, that it had marvelous qualities and serious faults, which, of course, it did, but that it was a terribly important book. Vance Bugelli called up one day and just said, I'd like to bring Jim Jones over. And I said, sure. So he came. He was there. We met that day.
You become friends pretty quickly?
Yeah. For one thing, it was like a joke. I once wrote a play about Eisenhower and Khrushchev, calling it buddies. They were the only equals in all the world. So they had to become friends. That was what the one-act play was about. And in a way, Jones and I were equals. We were the only two people who had the same kind of experience. Both young, both had written war novels, both had enormous receptions for their books. So in a certain sense, we felt like the Touchdown Twins.
It would be From Here to Eternity, if you want, if to write
a novel.
Yeah, and it's a novel that affected my own career, too, in a very beneficial way, although I didn't feel it at the time. But when I read that book, I was thinking I ought to write a novel, and the only thing I could write about would be my own war experience. And then when I read his book, I realized that better wait. I could not deal with the subject of war in a realistic way, in the way he did For Me to Eternity. Either I was never going to be a novelist, I'd better find a different way of writing about things.
You have to realize that at that time, From Here to Eternity was probably the most famous book in the entire world, of all languages. And I had also published a novel, my first novel, Lie Down in Darkness. And it was also well received, but it was of not the slightest comparison with Jim's in terms of either literary or popular success. I mean, one doesn't remember his books for the generals and the colonels and the sort of the Pattons or the MacArthurs. They're sort of vague, ephemeral figures, tremendously in the distance. And so you remember them for the poignancy of what it is to be the smallest cog in this terrible thing called war. And no one has ever caught it with such brilliance as he has.
The movie was censored in several cities, which undoubtedly added to its tremendous success. It won 7 Academy Awards, including Best Picture, and Donna Reed and Frank Sinatra won Oscars for Best Supporting Roles. Jones selected Clift to play Pruitt, and they became close friends, with Jones coaching him on Army life, including how to play the bugle. With the premiere of the movie in Robinson, the town grudgingly recognized the achievement of its rebellious son. The Handys were vindicated. Jones was triumphant. Jones pumped about $100,000 into the Handy Writers Colony in Marshall, about 30 miles north of Robinson. The colony was chartered in 1951, although it had been running since the late 40s. John Bowers, who arrived in the summer of 1952, later wrote an account of his 18 months there. George Gage's unfinished movie, based on Bowers' book, also called The Colony, gives a good sense of the rustic colony grounds, where anywhere from 2 to 17 writers tried to match the achievements of Loney's star pupil, who lived in his silver trailer on the grounds. Bowers talks about Jones' relationship with the other writers.
We held him in a great deal of awe, just sheer awe. We looked at him and we thought, God, under that Panama hat is a million-dollar brain. Here's a guy who sits down at the typewriter, looks at a blank page, and turns out marvelous dialogue. Here's a guy who knows how to tell a story and have it published and have all these accolades. And here's a guy who talks with the same, at that time he talked with a twang, and here's a guy, you know, who'll tell an awful joke, and here's a guy who's very human in many ways. So, you know, there were times when we would forget it. And also, he was not a fella who took on any airs, certainly.
The colony life, Loney run it with a strict hand. I mean, if any of those kids got out of line, boy, you could hear her cussing from clear across the country. They all had a little cabin, and she'd make them read or write or something half a day. And then the last half a day, they'd go out and work.
What was his relationship to Lonnie Handy?
Love of hate. I mean, I hate using something as simple as that, but it was the operative definition of it.
Was she as tough and as overbearing as people have described?
Well, she was terribly, such a terribly opinionated, and I could see if you were under her and she didn't like your work, you could hate her. But she had all sorts of interesting ideas. She was kind of a tyrant about writing. You know, she'd have these kids copy passages from great books and work on the typewriter that way for an hour a day before they start their own writing. And a lot of people have laughed at that, but I always thought, you know, it might be something worth trying.
You say that Loney had strong control over Jim. Did she have strong control over what he wrote, do you think?
Well, I don't think that's the right way to put it. I don't think she had control over what he wrote. She controlled his hours and undoubtedly helped discipline him to write. But to get his thoughts on paper and to get a book out of him. But Jim wrote everything that was published under Jim's name, in my strong view.
Jim lived in a trailer, and that was over on the other side of the pond. And we stayed here, and I used to hear all the guests who stayed in the Ramada when they would eat there, and Loney would keep the troops out of there. When Norman Mailer came and Montgomery Cliff, they drank champagne in there, and we stayed in these cabins. And the sound would waft across the pond, and we would drool, wanting to be over there with the champagne and the luminaries. Gosh, gosh, gosh. This is it. This is where I stay.
This is the room you were in?
The very room. I was in the end room. This is it. This is where I stay. Right here. God.
Mary Ann Crank, Civil War scholar, and John Bowers, author of several books, including The Colony, were only two of the dozens of writers who worked under Loney's tutelage. None of them matched Jones's achievements, although at least a dozen novels written at the colony found publishers. On Thanksgiving Day 1953, Jones moved into a large new house he had built near the colony grounds. After years of trailer living, he wanted space. With Harry Handy's help, he designed a dream house, complete with huge fireplace, bar, gun racks, and his initials carved in the lintel over the front door. Here observed by his son Jamie, who visited there in 1983. It was here that Jones wrote the bulk of his next book, Some Came Running, published in 1957. The novel tells the story of Dave Hirsch, played by Frank Sinatra, a returning GI with literary ambitions who fights to resist the pretensions and hypocrisies of his brother Frank, played by Arthur Kennedy. Shirley MacLaine and Dean Martin also starred in this movie, which, like the novel, was a commercial success. Book reviewers found little merit in the book, however, and many of the citizens of Robinson were appalled.
My husband and I stopped by the Legion to have a beer, and we suddenly looked around, and we were sitting at the bar in the Legion with the entire cast from Some Came Running. All of the people that Jim had used in the book, I think there were six of them, sitting around us, and we couldn't help but comment to one another, Jim would love this. This was after Jim had gone, but we knew who the people were he was pattering after, and when the book came out, the people in Robinson were just aghast.
The reaction of the townspeople of Robinson and Marshall was just one of several factors that made Jones decide to move. Another was the deterioration of his relationship with Loney.
Loney, after all, was 18 years old, older than Jim. Yet they had a strong relationship for many years. Why do you think that that relationship persisted?
I suppose it was an intimate one. It was taken for granted in our community and in the Marshall community that it was an intimate one. I felt, though, that, you see, she was the dominant character in the pair.
What did you think when you learned that Jim Jones had cut his ties with Loney?
I felt that Jim had finally matured. I was very, very happy for him. I felt that Jim, if he had any more writing in him, could not do it unless he was away from her.
It sort of hurt me, but that, you know, that was his decision.
Could you understand the decision?
I sure could.
What do you think it was based on?
Well, I think he wanted us to get away. And I think his, the control that Loney had over him was real strong. And I think he just wanted to break it.
Jones had another motive for leaving Loney and the colony. Her name was Gloria Mosolino. Moss, as her friends called her, grew up in Pottsville, Pennsylvania, and was an actress in New York City when Bud Schulberg introduced them in 1957.
He said, I'm lonely. And I said, what are you looking for? And he said, I need a woman. Not tonight, but I need a mate. I need someone I can live with. And I said, what kind of a woman? And he said, I'd like someone, I'll never forget this. He said, I'd like someone who looks like his sights were fairly high. He said, I'd like someone who looks something like Marilyn Monroe for openers, but who who's intelligent, who knows writers, who's interested in writing, has a great sense of humor. And so as he went on and on, I said, this is strange, but you're describing a friend of mine. There's a woman called Gloria Mosolino who is a stand-in for Marilyn, comes out of the same country that John O'Hara does, wrote a fairly credible novel. It could have been published. It was really pretty good. And is very interested in writing and writers. And she sounds like the answer to your dream. And he said, who'd you call her? She said, you know me well, Bud. Do you think I'll like him? And what I'm about to say sounds self-serving. I'm always a little embarrassed about it, but it might as well be on because it's true. I said to Gloria, called her Moss for Mosolino. I said, Moss, hold the phone tight and take a deep breath. I don't think you're just going to like him. I think you're going to marry him. True. And about 3 weeks later, they sent me a wire from Miami that they were on the way to Haiti, to the Olufsen's hotel. And I was really very pleased because it wasn't just a random thing. There was something about them. There was some quality in both of them. There was a chemistry that, I mean, I don't think it took any genius to think if these people meet that it will be something that will be lasting for all of their lives.
After the honeymoon, in the early spring of 1957, Jim and Gloria moved into his house in Marshall. Loney did not get along with Gloria. There were fights, bitter words, and within a few weeks, Gloria and Jim had moved to New York. Jones then set to work on The Pistol, a well-crafted novella set in wartime Hawaii. The split with Loney was permanent. She died in 1964. By this time, the Joneses were out of the country. They had moved to Paris in the summer of 1958. Gloria Jones explains why they moved.
Was there a specific reason why you wanted to go to Paris? I mean, did he have anything in mind?
Well, Django Reinhardt, remember I told you he was very interested in jazz and music, and he thought he could write a book about Django Reinhardt. He thought we'd stay 2 or 3 years. But we met everybody, all the jazz people, and then he realized that he didn't really understand gypsy people. Mm-hmm. And he said, this is not the book I can write. So, but we had a good time.
But you decided to stay, nevertheless, in Paris.
We decided because I think I got pregnant with Kaylie at that point, a year after that.
And my mother got pregnant with me, and my father, I said, well, why did we stay? And he said, well, we flipped a coin, heads or tails, go back to the States or raise you here, and came up heads, so we stayed.
I think Jim was merely following in the pattern of so many of us. By that time, we had become close friends. He'd become close friends of other American writers who had been abroad. I'd lived in Europe for several years. I think he wanted merely to experience the same thing that the rest of us had, a smell of Europe. America's a very provincial country, really. It's a totally parochial continent, even now, but especially then.
What was the Jones household like in Paris?
You went upstairs into this crazy plush living room filled with the kind of period furniture that you would never have guessed two Americans like Jim and Gloria would choose.
Yeah, the great piece of furniture in the house in Paris, though, was the pulpit, which was a, I don't know where Jim got it. It came out of a church somewhere. It was a rather ornate, heavy pulpit, and he used it as a bar. If you got on your high horse about something and you really wanted to make a statement, everybody was talking too loudly, why, Jim would say, let him take the pulpit. And you would then, I never did. I never got into one of those arguments, but apparently if you did, that was where you went and stood behind, and you could give your anti-French speech, or you could give your pro-Algeria speech, or whatever was the topic of the time.
You'd immediately fall into literary talk or political talk. There wasn't really small talk with Jim at all. There was always something really vital, and we would talk about poetry or talk about painting, and then suddenly the doorbell would ring, and a guest would come, and 3 guests, and 12 guests, and 20 guests, and by the end of the evening there'd be ambassadors and poets and people playing poker, and the house was just full.
After the long years of apprenticeship and dogged labor in Illinois, Jones relaxed a bit and savored the sweets of success in Paris. He continued to rise early and write, and in 1962, The Thin Red Line, his novel of the Guadalcanal campaign, was published to critical and popular acclaim. But he also traveled around Europe, spent time with his family, and generally enjoyed himself.
But when he first met a French oyster, for example, he ate 4 dozen. That's ballon. I thought he would die from. But he was so happy to eat. And when he first had a bottle of wine, he had 4. He couldn't believe such a thing was so good.
When he'd come down from his room after working all day, he'd be like dead. He'd be like tranced out. And then little by little, he'd come back. And another thing I always persuaded Jim to do was, after a day's work that night, read his recent pages. I mean, he read the entire Thin Red Line to me and Alice and Gloria.
And I still think the first half of the Thin Red Line is the best war writing there is. I mean, there's nothing that matches. I don't care who you talk about, Tolstoy, the rest of them. Second half is sort of an odd repeat of the first, but that first part of the Thin Red Line, I think, is matchless.
From 1963 to 1974, Jones published 5 volumes. Only one, Go to the Widowmaker, published in 1967, was of the scope of his earlier works. The Ice Cream Headache, 1968, was a collection of short stories dealing with his childhood in Illinois. The Merry Month of May, his 1971 novel, deals with the Paris revolts, and his 1973 detective story, A Touch of Danger, fared poorly. Viet Journal, a 1974 account of Jones' Vietnam trip, is a slim volume, but moving and poignant. The Thin Red Line and Go to the Widowmaker are the most important works of Jones' Parrish years.
From 1958 until 74, I think.
Why did you come back?
But he knew it was time to come back. We always planned to come back long before that.
I think a lot of it had to do with his sense of the shortness of time that he had. I think that he discovered his illness in my house on Martha's Vineyard in 1970, and it scared him.
But I think that Jim, who had been struggling with his final novel, Whistle, for many years, he conceived of it 30 years before his death, and he pretty much conceived of it as the capstone of his writing life, as the third volume in the Mammoth Trilogy, beginning with From Here to Eternity and The Thin Red Line. I think I sensed that something turned over in him in Paris. He just felt it was time to come home. And I think it was enmeshed in his own deep involvement in that book, Whistle. Also, I believe he wanted his children, who were going into their teenage years, to be Americans.
He'd give me a football and stuff like that, and softball, or we'd throw it around. For me, it was something new, because we'd come to the United States and do this. I didn't know what a mitt looked like. I didn't know it was a mitt, or a softball, or what a football looked like, and what you did with it. And he'd go through it with me, you know. We'd throw it around, because I think he really wanted me to know what America was like. Speaking English at home and French outside was already a distinction, which I was very aware, you know, well aware of, and I was very proud of being an American. I mean, to me, that meant a lot. People would call me Amerlok, which was like a nasty word for an American. It's like we call them frogs. And I was very proud of it. I thought that was great. I think, yeah, he's calling me Amerlok. You know, it's something that made me feel very good.
We were trying to find a way. We went into terrible debt at a certain point. Around then, the dollar changed. We were living too high. He took a job in Florida, International University. We moved to Florida. It was hard on the children, I think, but they were very good about it. Mm-hmm. He was writing a book during that time, too.
That's when he was working on...
He wrote us out of debt. He was Darling Planet.
That's when he was working on...
we lived on his salary, and he got a lot of money for that book, and then we were
that
totally
was World
out
War
of
II.
Debt. WW2, he called
WW2, yeah, yeah. He was working on yeah. that.
The Joneses moved to Sagaponack, Long Island in 1975. The same year his nonfiction narrative, WW2, was published. They bought an old farmhouse nicknamed Chateau Spud, and Jones set to work again on Whistle. Many of the Joneses' friends live nearby, including Shana Alexander and George Plimpton. And shown here before Bobby Van's restaurant in Bridgehampton, Truman Capote, Willie Morris, and John Knowles. Willie Morris, who wrote a memoir about his friendship with Jones, recalls the intensity of Jones' effort to complete Whistle.
Jim knew he was fighting against death, that it was going to be a struggle against time to finish this. I would see him put in 11, 12, 14 hours a day, which is an awesome amount of time for a novelist to put in on a book every day. And then he'd drift down from the attic and light up one of those big cigars of his and drink some white wine. But he was killing off the old company in Whistle, and in a curious way, I often thought that he didn't want to finish it.
He had a chair that went up, all the way up and down.
Just to save the strain so he could get beyond
it? I mean, I don't think he could walk. I mean, I don't think he possibly could have walked, but I don't know if we knew that. I don't know. I don't remember all of that. It's too horrible.
He almost died on I think it was a Sunday, which was about 3 days before he did die. In fact, the doctor came out and told Gloria and the kids and all the friends who were there that he was going to die momentarily. And he rallied that evening, and the doctor said that he'd been in heart medicine for many, many years, and he'd never seen a patient come back from the edge of death as Jim had. And late that night, Gloria and I were out there, and some of our friends, and he wanted to talk to me. I went into his room, and he got out of the bed, and he had that tape recorder. He said, "I want you to sit here with me, and I'm going to talk the conclusion of Whistle," which he did in the most eloquent and precise way.
I'd say that's probably his greatest book, and it's just such a shame that he couldn't finish it. It's just terrible.
But Willie Morris finished it, according to your father's instructions.
Absolutely. He spent all that time in the hospital with him at the end, and they tape recorded, and they talked and talked and talked it over, and Willie followed all the way through, you know, his writing of it. And at the end, Willie said, "Well, I can't finish it for you. I can't imitate your style. I can't write the book. All I can do is give a kind of book report of the end," which is what we ended up doing.
I saw him the day before he died. I went into the intensive care unit where he was lying. We both knew it was the last time I was going to see him. And I guess I looked a little gloomy. I said, "Irwin, you look worse than I do." And I said, "Sure, Jim, you haven't been drinking." He laughed, and he gave me the finger. And that was our last encounter.
I remember I was thinking shortly after his death that World War II was such an all-consuming event, perhaps the most momentous event in the history of the human race. And millions upon millions of men and women were caught up in it, many destroyed by it, consumed by it, and that this small-town boy from Robinson, Illinois, has given us this stunning corpus of work, perhaps the most significant and distinguished corpus of work on that catastrophic set of years than anyone else. A body of work that I have absolutely no doubt will be read and remembered and reread many hundreds of years from now to tell people what those years were really like. Not just on the battlefield, of course, but in the bars and on the drill fields and in the military hospitals, the hospital ships. What Memphis, Tennessee was really like in 1943. I've always felt that a substantial part of great writing is carrying the news from one generation to the next, and Jones's war work has certainly done that.
Prue took his quartz mouthpiece from his pocket and inserted it. He stood before the big tin megaphone, fiddling nervously, testing his lips. The first note was clear and absolutely certain. There was no question or stumbling in this bugle. It swept across the quadrangle positively, held just a fraction longer than most buglers hold it, held long like the length of time, stretching away from weary day to weary day. Held long like 30 years. The second note was short, almost too short, abrupt. Cut short and too soon gone, like the minutes with a whore. He played it all that way, with a paused, then hurried rhythm that no metronome could follow. There was no placid, regimented tempo to this taps. The notes rose high in the air and hung above the quadrangle. They vibrated there, caressingly, filled with an infinite sadness, an endless patience, a pointless pride, the requiem and epitaph of the common soldier, who smelled like a common soldier. This song is reality. Remember? Surely you remember. Day is done. Gone the sun. From the lake, from the hill, from the sky. Rest in peace. soldier brave. God,